like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea
morning, and I hope that you can sing It Is Well With My Soul. What a wonderful way to start the service off. Amen.
Amen.
So let's begin with a word of prayer. Lord, we thank you for today. We thank you for just the privilege to be here, and we thank you most of all for your salvation that you have so freely offered to whosoever will answer the call. And Lord, we just thank you for that confidence, for that hope, Lord, for that security, for that peace. Lord, just be with us now in this service, and we pray that we might just honor you in all that we do. In the precious name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen. I'll turn over to 484 this morning, Heavenly Sunlight, 484. Oh, 424, I'm sorry, I need my glasses.
Walking in sunlight all of my journey, over the mountains, through the deep veil. Jesus has said, I'll never forsake thee, promise divine that never can fail. Heavenly sunlight, heavenly sunlight, flooding my soul with thine. Hallelujah, I am rejoicing, singing his praises, Jesus is mine. Shadows around me, shadows above me, never conceal my Savior and guide. He is the light, in him is no darkness, ever I'm walking close to his side. Heavenly sunlight, heavenly sunlight, flooding my soul with glory divine. Hallelujah, I am rejoicing, singing his praises, Jesus is mine. In the bright sunlight, ever rejoicing, pressing my way to mansions above. Singing his praises, gladly I'm walking, walking in sunlight, sunlight of love. Heavenly sunlight, flooding my soul with glory divine. Hallelujah, I am rejoicing, singing his praises, Jesus is mine.
We want to, at this time, recognize someone that we're real proud of, and that's Mr. Brian King. He graduated from Kennesaw State University. Come on down. Give him a big hand. He has a bachelor's degree in accounting, and he is working toward his master's in accounting or in business?
Master's of Business Administration,
and looking for a job that pays big bucks with a paid vacation. That's what I told him. I told him that yesterday. I got first job I ever had where I got paid vacation. I was more excited about the paid vacation than I was the pay. So, well, what are you going to do with the rest of your life, Brian? Wherever God puts me. All right. Well, we're excited for you, and we appreciate all that you do and all your hard work. And here's a little something from the church. And what honors did you get? Your magna cum laude? Now tell everybody, what does that mean? Does that mean you're at the low end of the class? Or
it's 3.5 GPA or higher. I had a 3.78.
All right. Exactly. Any other awards? That diploma. All right. Thank you. Y'all be praying. Y'all be praying for Brian. So, and we're real excited. We're real excited for him and for that that accomplishment. A lot going on this morning. We appreciate the flowers this morning for Miss Barbara Shirley in memory of her son Clay, and appreciate her doing that. You see all the announcements that are listed. Please note, for those who are working with Vacation Bible School, make sure you touch base with Sherry this afternoon. She needs to meet with you for just, are you still meeting with everybody? Okay.
Yep.
And so this is primarily the teachers and the craft people and all, not necessarily the cooks, right?
Not necessarily the cooks. Yeah.
Because we got the cooks we need somewhere else. So yes. We've also got a Bill and Grounds Committee meeting. That's why the cooks, unless you need instruction, Wayne, on how to cook. But anyway, we'll work that out. But Bill and Grounds Committee, we need to meet back in the conference room right after the service. We are going to have a call conference this morning right after at the end of the service to elect messengers to the Southern Baptist Convention in New Orleans the week of June 12th through the 14th. Renee and I will be going to that, and I want you to be praying for the convention. It's a lot of stuff going on, and we just need a lot of prayers. We have shared blessings this week at 11:30 on Thursday, and encourage you to come and to be a part of this. It's a potluck dinner. And We'll have pulled pork and barbecue sauce on the side that the church that Shared Blessings will provide. But to encourage you to come, encourage you to bring someone. And then the next week, we're going to have a classic board game challenge. What day is that? Thursday? Tuesday? At what time? At 1. So that'll be Tuesday the 13th at 1 o'clock, and we'll mention that again next week. This Saturday is Vacation Bible School. Please be much in prayer for the children. We have 16, how many do we, 16? Or
yes, roughly.
Somewhere in there signed up. Hopefully we'll get some more. If you know of someone who could come, there's still plenty of time. They can even show up on Saturday at 1 o'clock, and we'll take care of that. But we're excited. Be praying for the workers, but be praying especially for the children. If you want to help during Bible school, there's always something to do. Then make sure you see Sherry this afternoon or during the week. But I also want to encourage you, for those of you that may not be helping in Bible school, you may not be teaching or doing anything, I still want to ask you, encourage you to come back at 6 o'clock. We're going to have hamburgers and hot dogs, have some stuff for the children and meet with the parents, and we want the church to come back and to meet with them. And this is an opportunity for us to be with these families and just to talk to them and encourage them and hopefully draw some of them into the church and help them come to faith in Christ. And this is so important. So I encourage you to be praying about that. Also, we have a tentative date on working in the sanctuary. And we're shooting for the week of July the 11th. So we'll meet here in the sanctuary July the 10th, and then that Monday is when they're going to come supposedly and start working in here. So for the next couple of weeks after that, we'll meet down in the fellowship hall. We're excited about that and what the Lord is doing. We have all of these on our prayer list to remember for prayer. You may have to help me if something else. I am aware of Miss Glenda Hurst. Miss Glenda has been having some abdominal pain all week. They finally took her to St. Joe, and they're running some tests on her. They think it's her gallbladder, but they're trying to figure out more precisely what's going on. So y'all pray for Miss Glenda. Anything else we need to mention? Margaret Morris.
Some of you may remember a couple that used to come here, Terry and Terry Abbott. So it's Man Terry. And you know, he had the liver transplant and all of that. But he's in pretty bad shape again. And he's got a lot of decisions that has to be made here shortly concerning his colon. And they're just, they're both in need of a lot of prayer right now. So I just want to ask y'all to please pray for both of them, but mostly for him, and that the right decisions can be made for him.
He's got a lot of life-altering decisions to make. So some tough choices. What else? All right. Any unspoken concerns? All right. Let's pray. Lord, we just thank you for today. We thank you for the privilege to be here in this place. We thank you most of all, Lord, that you're here with us, that you love us, that you've saved us, and we just thank you for this very special time that we have with you today. Lord, we pray for our country, a lot going on. We pray, Lord, for the Southern Baptist Convention. Pray for the meeting that will be held next week, Lord, that you will be honored. Lord, we pray for these on our prayer list and for all of these we've mentioned, for these unspoken concerns, and just pray that, Lord, you would just work and do what only you can do. Lord, I pray for each one of us here and those that are on watching online. Lord, just encourage us, draw us closer to you, Help us as we worship you, Lord, that we might experience your presence and your power. Help us to focus upon you, Lord, and to push away the distractions of the world. Lord, help us to hear your word. In the precious name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Turn over now to 441, Since Jesus Came Into My Heart, 441. What a wonderful change in my life has been wrought since Jesus came into my heart. I have light in my soul for which long I had sought since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Floods of joy o'er my soul like the sea billows roll. Since Jesus came into my heart. I'm possessed of a hope that is steadfast and sure. Since Jesus came into my heart. And no dark clouds of doubt now my pathway obscure. Since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Floods of joy o'er my soul like the sea billows roll. Since Jesus came into my heart. There's a light in the valley of death now for me. Since Jesus came into my heart. And the gates of the city beyond I can see. Since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Floods of joy o'er my soul like the sea billows roll. Since Jesus came into my heart. I shall go there to dwell in that city I know. Since Jesus came into my heart. And I'm happy, so happy, as onward I go, since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Floods of joy o'er my soul like the sea billows roll. Since Jesus came into my heart. Amen. Now y'all pray for the choir this morning. We're going to do He Set Me Free.
Once like a bird in prison I dwell, no freedom.
Thank you, choir. This morning, if you will, turn to John chapter 3 for our scripture passage. It's good to be back this morning. It's nice to take some time off, and I really appreciate you as a church giving me that opportunity. I want to thank Renee and my family for their love and support while I spent a lot of the time in North Carolina. Especially grateful for Willow. You know, it's nice to be missed. And Willow made sure I knew that she missed her Poppy. She's special. I want to thank Brother Tim and the deacons for handling things and taking care of things during the month, and Brother David for leading the worship service and taking care of Wednesday nights. Thank you, brother. Appreciate Brother Randy for being here every Sunday, preaching great messages each week, and I'm excited about my mind's just gone. Clark, excited about Clark surrendering to the ministry. Clark Tucker, he preached one Wednesday night for us, and I'm excited about that. But I just want to thank you as a church for just your love and support and prayers during this time. I just appreciate that very much. A couple of funny things happened before we get to Scripture. Let me just share this. We visited a church and ran into a preacher friend of mine who's on staff there. He said, "Now, how long were you at Union Grove? Because I was at my church." And I said, "Well, I hope I'm still there. I hope they haven't run me off." And I am going to say I was a little disappointed. Nobody volunteered to hoe out my corn patch while I was gone. And in fact, one of my neighbors, Jerry Glover, I think he got worried about me because he came by every day and saw my corn patch look pitiful, and he called to check on me, but I think he really wanted to see what was going on while I hadn't cleaned the corn patch out. Some of you may ask, well, what did you do? We were able to visit some other churches. You know, a preacher can't visit another church because he's got to preach at his church, and that was neat, and got to see some things. Got to spend some time with family, but most of all, I got to do some trout fishing, which I love to do. And I think now I can say I'm not just a scarer of fish, but I also actually catch some fish. I really enjoy fishing for wild trout in the mountains. My brother says it's a waste of time because they're so little, but it's a great challenge, and I really enjoyed that. It was extremely nice not to have to worry about anything or anybody. Didn't have to get back at a certain time or worry about what time it was. And I really appreciate that. This morning, we're going to look at this passage. We've looked at it before. But one of the things that I was reminded of as we visited some churches today is how, if we're going to be faithful to the Lord, and if we're going to be a church, folks, just because we call ourselves a church doesn't make us a church. We're only a church if we do what the Lord has called us to do. And if we're going to be His church, then we must keep evangelism at the forefront of everything we do. So I want us to look at this passage, John chapter 3, beginning with verse 1. If you would please stand as we honor the reading of God's word. And the word of God says, "There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, 'Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God, for no man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him.' Jesus answered and said unto him, 'Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, He cannot see the kingdom of God. And Nicodemus said unto him, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? And Jesus answered, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I say unto thee, you must be born again. Let's pray. Dearly Father, we thank you so much for the privilege to be here. We're so grateful for your precious word, for your presence, your spirit in our midst. Lord, speak to us. Lord, I pray if there's one here in this building, one watching this online, Lord, that does not know you as their Lord and Savior, that today will be the day where they get right with you. Lord, help us as your people to never forget, Lord, that the only difference between us and lost folks is the precious gift of your salvation and your grace. Have your way in our hearts and lives. In the precious name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. You may be seated. The phrase born again became very prominent in the 60s and the 70s with the Jesus People Movement. And it was used to refer to a person's personal experience with Christ. Then in 1975, Chuck Colson wrote a book entitled Born Again. And in that book, he shared his memoirs of how he went from being part of Nixon's staff. In fact, he was called his hatchet man, did a lot of stuff. Was sent to prison for his involvement in the Watergate scandal. While he was there, he came to faith in Christ and was a changed man. Joshua and I had the privilege to meet him at Beeson Divinity School some years back. And let me just tell you, he was a man who loved the Lord and who had given his life to serve him. Then in 1976, Jimmy Carter, running for president, described himself as being a born-again Christian. Incidentally, that year, every one of the presidential candidates claimed they were born again as well. We often talk about that term, born again. Sometimes I think people use it, and they may not even know what it means. And folks, I want us to look at this for just a little bit this morning. What does it mean for us to be born again? Because I want to tell you something. The devil has a lot of people confused and deceived. They think that they're okay. They think that they're going to heaven when they're not. You may say, well, preacher, why in the world would you say that? Why are you trying to scare us? No, folks, I am not trying to scare anybody. But folks, one thing I want to make clear today is you better make certain that you know that you're a child of God. You better not have any doubts about that one issue. And folks, you know, I've run into people over the years. I ran into a preacher one time. He was not a Baptist preacher, but he said he hoped he made it to heaven. I looked at him like he was crazy. And I've thought about that over the years. Folks, God, if I know I'm a Hennessy, I tell y'all this all the time, I'm a Hennessy. I am the child of my mother and my father. I was not adopted like my brother told me when I was little. Okay? I know that. I know it for many reasons. There is no question in my mind. Folks, if I know that, God wants us to know if we belong to Him. Amen? And we need to be certain about this issue. here in this story, Jesus has just begun his ministry. He's starting out, but he's gaining popularity, and people are following him, and they're amazed at all of the things that he does. And one night, he has a visit by a man named Nicodemus. We're told several things about him. He was a Pharisee, which meant that he was a devout follower of the law being the first five books of the Old Testament. He took it very seriously, and he genuinely tried to keep the law according to the Jewish traditions. He was also a ruler of the Jews, which meant he was part of the Sanhedrin. This meant that he was involved with most of the legal matters that came before the Jews. Remember, Jesus himself was carried before the Sanhedrin, and they were the ones that took him to Pilate and wanted to sentence him to death. We also know that he was probably very rich. Some believe that he could have been one of the three richest men in Jerusalem. Because of that, because of who he was and his position and being ruler, he had a person of great influence. But we're also told that he really sought to live a life that honored God. There were a lot of Pharisees that they cared more about their rules and regulations, and they really didn't care about God. And when the very Son of God came and was in their midst and spoke to them, they did not recognize him because they did not know God. They claimed to. When Jesus said they didn't know God, they got mad and red in the face. But folks, they didn't know him. But folks, Nicodemus, he was serious. And he comes to the Lord. And he comes to him at night with a very important question. And he really doesn't ask the question in the text, but he asks it. This is at the forefront. Now, over the years, people have said, well, why did he go at night? Was he ashamed? Was he embarrassed? I think it's really a pretty simple explanation. This was a serious matter, and he wanted Jesus' undivided attention. He didn't want a bunch of people around. He didn't want other people asking questions. He wanted time alone with the Lord. And the only time to do that was at night. And so he goes to him. And whether he asks a question or not, because Jesus answers the question, he goes to the Lord and he asks the question, Lord, what do I need to do to make sure that I'm going to go to heaven? Now he knew the Old Testament. He was a devout follower of the law, the Old Testament law. In his mind, he had done everything that was required of him. But in the back of his mind, he still did not have that certainty, that assurance that he had done everything. And so he's asking Jesus, Jesus, what's that one thing I need to do? That if I do this, I can check off my list and I can have the certainty that I'm going to go to heaven and I don't have to worry about this anymore and I don't have to do anything else anymore. I can just be content because I know that I'm right with God and I'm going to go to heaven. Isn't that just like us? What do I need to do to get right with God? I heard Vice President Kamala Harris the other day, bless her heart. She was so excited because of some initiative that they're doing to save the planet. We're going to save the earth. Now, folks, y'all, I've said this over and over again. Folks, we can't save this earth. We can't save it. it's going to be destroyed. And we're foolish to think that we can save it. But folks, we also need to understand we can't save ourselves. There's not something we can do. And we need to understand, folks, that the most important question that we will ever answer in our life, it's not where we're going to go to college. It's not, I'm going to pick on Brian for a minute, it's not what kind of job am I going to get. I am proud of him. I didn't mention this. He's wearing socks today. I'm so proud of you. You're so big today. You are grown up. I'm sorry, I couldn't help that. But you know, we often focus on certain things and we're like, oh, this is the most important. Folks, the most important question we can ever ask is, how do we know for certain that we're going to go to heaven when we die? I see this at funerals. Sometimes I get called in to do a funeral for somebody who doesn't have a pastor. And folks, this really bothers me now because it's almost like, we got to have a funeral, we got to have a preacher, and I go and I do what I can, but it's like it just goes over the top of their heads because they don't have any connection with the church. They don't know Jesus as their Lord and Savior. And so when we go through the funeral, there's no comfort there. But folks, the most important question is, what have you done with Jesus? Because you see, we're made in the image of God. Have you ever seen anybody, not anybody here at the church, but have you ever seen anybody do anything just absolutely crazy? Like, what, you know, some of these thrill seekers and, you know, some of these people that just do crazy things. Folks, and you might think, well, what's wrong with them? I know what's wrong with some of them. They need Jesus. But folks, that's what's wrong with every person here on this earth. We need Jesus. And until we're right with Jesus, until this question is answered and we have that assurance, then we're going to have an emptiness in our life. There's going to be something missing, and we're not going to be right. We're not going to be whole. We're not going to be content until we are right with the Lord. Sadly, many people don't understand what they're missing. That's why they get into drugs. That's why they get into alcohol. That's why they get addicted to work or whatever. They're trying to find something to bring meaning and purpose to their life. But folks, what we need is Jesus. And I'm so grateful that Nicodemus was smart enough to know who to go to. He went to Jesus. Amen. He went to the one who could actually help him. How did Jesus respond? Jesus did not respond the way Nicodemus thought he would. Nicodemus thought Jesus would say, Nicodemus, if you'd make a very large donation to the temple, that will secure your place in heaven. Or, if you will devote your Sundays to taking care of widows for the rest of your life, that's going to secure your place. Or if you'll do this, or if you'll do that, then that will take care of it. That's what he was expecting. Jesus said, you must be born again. How do you think Nicodemus responded to that? I think he was like, Jesus, have you lost your mind? Amen? He understood life. He understood that when a child is born, they're not born non-binary, they're born male or female. He understood that you grow up and then at some point you die. He didn't know nothing about this being born again. Jesus said, you're going to go to heaven. If you want that assurance, you must be born again. Now, what does he mean? He means by being born again that it's something that we can't do. It's something that only God can do. It is the work of the Spirit. Folks, we need to understand this. When a person is born again, when a person repents of their sins and trusts Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, they are spiritually born again by the Spirit and power of God. See, some people, They think being born again is just joining the church. Or just being baptized. Oh, I want to be baptized. You know, when our children come up and start expressing faith in the Lord, you know, it's very important to me that they understand baptism is not what saves us. What saves us is trusting Jesus, repenting of our sins. When we're saved, we are spiritually made alive. Paul says we were dead in our sins, but we've been made alive in Christ. It is the work of the Spirit. Now how are we born again? If you look down to verse 15 of this chapter, Jesus said, whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. I think we've had some confusion over the years. We've made salvation so easy that people think it's just some kind of agreement or acceptance to come to faith in Christ. Folks, I want to encourage you that when Jesus said believe on him, he meant more than just accepting who he was. Because what did the demons do when Jesus was here on this earth and he encountered somebody who was filled with demons? What did they say? Not the person, the demons. They knew exactly who Jesus was. Amen? They knew his authority. They knew his power. They even obeyed him. When he told them to go out, they did. And so when he says, believe on me, what he's saying is, believe that I am the very Son of God who came to save you from your sins. Believe that you're lost and that you're heading for hell and that you cannot get there on your own, and be willing to give your life to me. That's more than just agreeing to something. Amen? It's where we surrender ourselves to him. I want you to notice one more thing here with what Jesus said. He said, you must be born again. You. I've shared this before, but I used to work with a boy. And we worked close to where he must have grown up, because whenever I talked to him about his faith in the Lord, he always would say one of these two things. He immediately shifted the subject off of himself, started talking about what his mama did at the church. His mama was in WMU and did this and did that. Or his dad was a deacon in that church and his dad did this or did that. He never would talk about himself. Folks, nobody can get you into heaven. The only way we can get to heaven is if we ourselves are personally born again, and that only occurs if we admit that we're a sinner and that we're willing to trust Jesus and give our life to Him. And then I want you to notice, there is no other way. Look at what Jesus said, last part of verse 3. Verily I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Now folks, this is very important. We live in a very pluralistic society. We live in a time in our culture where everybody wants to say, oh, just let everybody do and believe whatever they want to. And that's fine, they can. But they need to understand that we know the truth and we're going to tell what God's Word says. And God's Word says if you're a Muslim, the only way you're going to get to heaven is not by following Islam, but by trusting Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. If you're a pagan, we may get flagged on YouTube, I don't know. If you're a pagan and you go out and you worship the earth, folks, you're going to hell unless you repent of your sins and trust Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And folks, please understand that. I see reports every now and then of how even inside the church, less than 50% of people who claim to be evangelical Christians actually believe Jesus is the only way. Folks, if there was any other way, Jesus would have never come. Amen? He came because there is no other way. And we have to share the truth. Then finally, when we're born again, supernaturally, we will never, ever be the same. Growing up, I always had a connection with my grandmother. Maybe it's just in my head, but I always felt like we understood each other, and there was just something there. We worked a lot together. We just had a bond. I identified with her. You know, my dad, I didn't really identify with him. Then he died. And you know what? All of a sudden I realized, I'm just like my dad. I'm just like my mother. But when, I don't know why, but it hit me. When my dad died, I would do something. I'm like, oh, Lord. Let me just tell y'all, if y'all see me drag out a bunch of PVC pipe over here to church, y'all better get worried, okay? That's all I'm going to say. My dad loved PVC pipe. But folks, why do I do that? Because I'm related to my father. Amen. And every one of you can relate at some point. You may not right now. But at some point, it's going to hit you. You're just like, you know, you're going to do something. Oh, my mom used to do that. Or my dad. My brother and my uncle are very much alike. And they did not grow up. My brother didn't grow up around my uncle, but they are alike because of genetics. And folks, if we've been born again, then we're going to act like we are a child of God. Please hear me. I hear people say, I love Jesus. I love Jesus. I'm a Christian. I'm going to go to heaven when I die. But I don't like the Bible. I don't go to church. I don't care nothing about the church. I go out and I party. I do this. I do that. But I'm going to heaven when I die because I got saved. Folks, I'm not so sure about that. Now, folks, we all sin. We all get away from the Lord. But if we're a child of God, we won't stay there. Amen? Folks, if we claim to be a Christian, but we show no evidence or sign that we're a child of God, folks, you better get a little nervous. In fact, you better get a whole lot nervous. And you better make sure that you truly gave your heart and your life to Jesus and that you're following Him, that you love His Word. Folks, if you love Jesus, you're going to love His Word. Amen? You're going to love the preaching and teaching of His Word. Well, preacher, if you had to listen to what we had to listen, have to listen to, not Randy, but me, you'd be bored too. Folks, it's not about me. It's about God and His Word and being submissive to what He's saying to us. Amen? If we love the Lord, we're going to want to be around people that love the Lord. If we love the Lord, we're going to want to serve Him. Folks, we sang some great songs this morning about, but it is well with my soul and what the Lord has done for us. Folks, if we truly understand what Jesus has done for us, we can't do enough for Him. And how are we to serve Him? It's not outside and apart from the church. It's inside the church. It's through the church. When our kids were born, Jennifer, Megan, and Matthew, Renee's mother was so excited. And she said immediately when she saw them, "Oh, they look just like Renee did. Oh, they're so cute." When Joshua was born, she didn't say anything for a couple of days. Because he was a spitting image of my baby pictures. Finally, she said, "Well, I guess he just looks like Kenneth." She couldn't find anything. But you know what? Now, Matthew and Joshua look an awful lot alike. Why? Because they look like their mama and their daddy. Paul says, "As the earthly, such are they also that are of the earth, and as is the heavenly, such are they also that are of the heavenly. As we've borne the image of the earthly, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither doth corruption inherit incorruption." Folks, do we demonstrate by our life that we know the Lord, that we're His child? Do we have to tell people we're Christian? Or do they think we're just like them? Folks, if we're just like them, if they don't see any difference from us, we better get right with God, because we're not right with Him. And the first thing we better do is make sure we really are His child. Are we obeying Him? You know, the Bible tells us when we come to faith in Christ, first thing we need to do is confess Him before men. We need to tell other people, and we do that as we come and unite with a local church. And then we're baptized. Why do we do that? It's an act of obedience. But it's just the beginning of being obedient to Him. And then we need to seek to become like Him as we spend time in His Word. So we seek to serve Him, to be engaged in His work. As we become more like Him. We were so honored to celebrate Brother Johnny White, who was saved in this church next door, the old sanctuary, surrendered to the ministry, served as a pastor and preacher for over 50 years. And you know what was neat about Johnny? Johnny's a simple man. But he was a man who gave his heart and his life to Jesus. And oh, what the Lord did through him. Amen. A lot of people didn't know Johnny White. Some of you didn't know Johnny White. He's with the Lord now. But folks, just being with him, you saw a man who gave himself to the Lord. Now, some of you may be saying, well, he was a preacher. Yeah, he was. But folks, that ought to be said about every one of us if we're a child of God. Folks, people ought to know we're a Christian, not because we say we are, but because of the way we live our life. They ought to at least know something weird about us. They ought to question and want to ask us, why are you the way you are? And you get to say, because Jesus, amen. Because Jesus has saved my soul. Now, why does this matter? Matters because man's still lost. Hell is real. But Jesus' blood is still more than sufficient and always will be to save us from all our sins. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for today, for your precious word. Most of all, we're grateful for your precious gift of salvation that you willingly offered your life as a sacrifice for our sins. Lord, I pray if there's anyone here today who has never trusted you as their Lord and Savior, Lord, they know it. They've been struggling with it. Lord, help them to take that step of faith. Help them to make that decision today. And Lord, I pray if there's someone here this morning or Lord, I pray someone watching online, Lord, if Lord, they've been struggling too because they're not sure. Lord, help them to come forward and settle this issue for all of eternity. Because, Lord, we must be born again. Lord, have your way in our hearts and lives. In the precious name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.